You're listening to the Deep Purple Podcast, a fan podcast about one of the most legendary bands of all time, Deep Purple. We take a look at the music, history, and people behind the band Deep Purple, and beyond. Welcome to the Deep Purple Podcast, the first and only podcast devoted to one of the greatest bands in rock history, Deep Purple. Today's episode is episode number 129, Rainbow on Stage. And coming to you smack dab in the middle of the suburbs of Chicago, I'm your host, Nathan Beaudry.
And coming to you 1 foot away from Nate, I'm your co-host, John 19 Crimes Mottola.
There were 19 crimes last night, and 1 foot away. Now they can try. Well, they can't triangulate you because you've moved.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Yep. You're just gonna have to wait and see if I.
But 1 foot away, we are like, even less maybe.
Maybe.
Look at that. So John's in the studio. This will be the first. Yeah. Well, no, I guess this will be the second one, depending on how we do our Dead Daisies episode tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Who knows? We're in a time warp right now, folks. With everything going on, it's crazy. Recording episodes out of order. Don't know what to tell you, but. This is our first stab at a live album live stream. So we're opening it up to whoever wants to participate, join us as we record an episode live. So we'll just be doing an episode like we normally do it, but we'll have people chiming in and people that are going to have things to say and can add some extra commentary, and probably people that know a lot more about these albums than we do that can lend a little bit of support. So thank you to everybody for chiming in. We've got a few... You know, before we get into thanking the patrons formally, we've got a few patrons in the audience. We've got Will Porter there. We've got Fielding Fowler. We got Peter Gardeau. We've got Rich, the honorary patron. The patron of, although he's probably donated more to John in the form of alcohol than
the patron saint of Magners.
And we've got Colin Whiting. So thank you, everyone, for joining us, and we'll see if anyone else is gonna pop in during the episode. Who knows, it's anybody's guess. But yeah, so here we are trying this ridiculous thing, and one thing that is worth mentioning is we're going to be listening to the vinyl copies that were given to us by Norman Weichelbaum. So thank you, Norman, for that. He happened to, when he sent us that big album package, donated a bunch of albums, including these three live albums. So we'll be starting today with On Stage, Rainbow album. So very excited to get into that. So if you are interested in helping support the Deep Purple Podcast, you can do it a number of ways. You can leave us a 5-star rating on Apple Podcasts. You can, of course, buy some merch at our Etsy store, which we are not even wearing our own merch. So there you go. There's one hanging on the wall outside, out of sight. It's usually right behind me.
Where is that? Oh, there it is.
And you, again, of course, you can become a patron on Patreon or PayPal for as little as $1 a month. Speaking of the patrons, who do we have? None other than at the £10 tier, Dr. Jill Brees. At the turn it up to $11 tier, we have Clay Wambacher, Frank Thielgard Mortensen, Alan Ain't Too Proud to Beg, and Mikkel Steen. And at the $10 someone came tier, Steve Seaborg of nameonanything.com and alltheworldsastage.net, Ryan M, Jeff Bryce, Gerald Kelly, and Victor Campos. Thank you to all of you for your amazing support of the Deep Purple Podcast. All right, so John, do you have any sort of background with On Stage?
You know what? let me see.
What is this album?
what are we doing here? Hey, look, I finally get to hold one of my albums.
Just don't take it with you.
No. Wow, this is really cool. Actually, you know what? I don't think that I ever really listened to the... I mean, I'm sure I have, but I mean, it's not one that I've listened to time and again, like like Blackmore's Rainbow and Rising and Long Live Rock and Roll. Those were like the three Rainbow albums that I really got into. So like this one, all the 80s albums, like I really didn't discover until later. So I think it's because I wasn't too much into live albums.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there we go.
There goes the banging.
So I've heard tracks off of this before, but you know, I don't have any particular like strong memory of it, other than that, you know, It's got classic versions of, you know, pretty much every great song on here.
Yeah. And it's, so yeah, this is an interesting album in the fact that the Kill the King on this album came out before the actual Long Live Rock and Roll. So people were listening to this live version, opening the album with a live version of a song that hadn't been released yet, which is kind of interesting. I don't know how many, I don't know if it's unprecedented, but I don't know how many other albums had really done that before as far as live albums. But you want to do me a favor? Well, I'll talk through a little bit of this. You want to go close the door at the top of the stairs? Mm. It might block out some of the banging.
Noise a little bit, yeah.
Of course. Well, you know, hey, if that's the worst thing that happens and our show isn't canceled because of COVID, then I'll take it. But so yeah, this is a double album that was recorded in 1976 in Germany and Japan during the world tour for Rising. And like a lot of albums at this time, a lot of the stuff was spliced together from various shows and tracks spliced together. So, and of course, there'll probably be some crowd noise piped in and all that sort of stuff. But from what I understand, from what you're hearing, is a real, you know, is a good. And we don't really care about that stuff anyway. Do you close the door? You're so quiet.
Yes, I'm very stealthy.
You are stealthy, but the you know, we're not really a huge you know, like a lot of people are like, oh, it has to be pure, it has to be 100% live. And I mean, I think what you're hearing is some really good live performances, but they've spliced a few together, taken some from different shows, probably bumped up the crowd noise.
Yeah, but you know what? The thing about live albums, especially as you get older, and you realize what they are, is like, you can't, it's just like reality TV almost, you know, you can't just, you know, hit record and do a live album. Like, it's not so much about capturing what actually happened that night. It's about capturing like the essence of what going to that show was. So if they have to splice together a few different dates, which people have done, pipe in crowd noise, fix a bum note here or there, I mean, you know, then you do it, you know?
Yeah. And I think it's about, I know like Chris says on Pot of Thunder a lot that when you go to a live show, your brain sometimes fills in the things that are missing or the things that are wrong.
Right.
And then when you listen back to a recording, you maybe don't you hear it a little bit more clearly. And I think that's kind of what they try to do is, and sometimes, I don't know if you've ever done this, but you hear like somebody has recorded like a live speech, like in front of an audience, and they're making all these jokes and it sounds like they're falling flat and like nobody's laughing because they haven't actually mic'd the audience properly.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you're listening to that, it might just sound awkward and uncomfortable. And it's actually a better experience to pipe in some laughing or boost it up or in some way, because otherwise it just sounds like the person's on stage making a fool of themselves.
Right. I mean, that's why they, you know, pipe in like laugh tracks and stuff on comedy albums, sitcoms. They've been doing that for years, you know.
But imagine if they were just playing and then you just heard like really faintly in the background, just like, you'd be like, wow, that they're really bombing on stage. They're just rainbow on stage bombing.
Yeah, well, yeah, nobody wants to hear that.
No. So, I mean, we have no problem with this. So it's interesting. It's actually really cool, cool sleeve, I think. So this is the classic, I guess you would call this the classic lineup, right? You've got Jimmy Bain, Cozy Powell, Ritchie Blackmore, Tony Carey, and of course, Ronnie James Dio on vocals.
Yeah, that's the Rising. The Rising lineup.
Yep.
So the classic 70s lineup, at least.
And then you've got Martin Birch as producer, just plain regular flavored vanilla Martin Birch. And
that's what he does for live albums, just Martin Birch.
Martin Birch. Well, we'll see about that later. So the photography in here is by Dieter Zill or Didi Zill, which we went through his photo book last night, opened my copy, which is right up there for the first time after buying it like 2 years ago, and actually looked through it together on the stream. And I'm sorry if anyone's in the chat right now, but I was on the show notes thing. So, Will Porter says, shortchanged when I first bought this album around 1980, not that long. The LP1 was 32 minutes, LP2, 31 minutes, and criminally no Stargazer. I know, right? Were they even playing Stargazer live? I know that there's precious few. I think is Munich, maybe they have a live Stargazer. I don't know, but I know there's not a ton of live Stargazers with Ronnie. at least with this Ronnie. Mm-hmm. So this additionally on the back cover of the album is the most insane,
pretty elaborate
equipment. I mean, it's cool because it's got that same book on rainbow. It says Rainbow World Tour in rainbow colors around the edge, and then you've got that same border on the other side, which I don't know if you can, it might be too washed out here, but it's got the most insane equipment list. Look at this. I'm not going to read the whole thing because the episode will end, but it goes through 6 Crown DC300A power amps, 3 wired amp racks, 3 Crown VFX electric crossovers, down and down and down the list ends with 1 15-inch crash, 1 pair of 15-inch hi-hats, 1 times 6-inch splash, 6 Ludwig 35. Goes through every single piece of equipment that anyone's on stage is using. It looks almost like a manifest that they give to the crew. Hey, make sure we get all this stuff packed for the show.
Yeah, but it's just like that whole guitar, acoustic guitar, Fender guitar, Leslie guitar. It's like, all right, guitar, we got it.
Got hurt, we hear you loud and clear. But I want, it's almost like you could buy all of this stuff and perform with all of the exact same equipment. It even says, look here, the rainbow, 40 foot span across the stage, 29 feet high in the middle, made from 4 sections, 4 foot wide by 4 foot deep times 15 foot long. And it still goes down. It still has like 9 or 10 more lines.
So are you saying that if we bought all this crap, we could recreate a 70s rainbow concert?
I think we could. I don't think we could get 29 feet high in this room, but
definitely not.
But yeah, this is a crazy, crazy, crazy. But yeah, I see what Will's saying. You know, that is one thing that kind of surprised me. The sides on these albums are very short. So it's a double album, but you've got 16 minute side, a 15 minute side, a 13 minute side, and an 18 minute side. So those are pretty short sides. So it's about roughly an hour or so, it looks like.
I don't think I've ever seen like a double album set that's that short.
And two of the sides just have one song each. So you know those are going to be good. But yeah, pretty cool gatefold there. Good quality album. This is, of course, the German release, I believe. Yep, that was sent to us by Norman, so thank you very much. Art direction on the album by Finn Costello, designed by Ken Anderson, and then photography by Watal Asanuma and Watanabe, which is, this is the only credit on Discogs, so I don't know, sometimes that happens and it's something weird, but don't know. But ready to put this on the turntable. We're kind of getting right to it this morning.
Yeah. Ready to drop the needle on some of these tracks.
Yeah. And when we do that, well, first of all, you guys will have to let us know if it actually, if you can hear it. Hopefully this works. And then, oh, actually worth mentioning, the there's got a insert in here.
Nice.
Which is really nice. Rainbow on stage. And then it's got a little booklet of photos in there that are kind of falling out. But Norman took very good care of his albums. So like the picture of Dio just belting it out and having a smoke while he's doing it.
It's just like, nah.
That's my Dio impression. Spot on.
Perfect. Perfect.
I know you thought he just walked in the room. The hologram is resurrected. Wendy Dio was in the news recently saying like something about the hologram, about they were asking her why they didn't bring the hologram back, and she's like, she was like, oh, the hologram just could never compare with, or it wasn't the same as having Ronnie do it. But like, well, didn't we always know that wasn't an option?
Yeah. We made enough money off of it, or we're gonna lose money off of it,
or we realized a lot of people gave us a lot of crap about it.
We realized that it just wasn't that great.
All right, so let's see how this works to get this sweet, sweet. You know what? Let's put this here, and we can put maybe on stage here.
Oh, there we go.
Stir and then see what happens here. If this works. We might need to crank the volume from the computer here.
There we go. A little glare on the album.
There we go. Okay. So it's going. You'll have to let us know in the chat if you can hear this. So.
Oh, wow. I can hear the clicks and the pops. I love it.
Yeah. I'll have to remember to turn off our normal filter that gets rid of all the clicks and the pops that are coming from that are coming from our cameras or our internet connection. Loud and reasonably clear. Thank you, Rich.
Right.
All right. If it's too loud and you can't hear us, then maybe that's a good thing. Will saying he's got it. Good. Start.
I always love that.
Very nice. Cool. Rocked up over the rainbow.
Judy Garland would be rocking in her grave.
Well, she wouldn't have been in her grave at this point, right? She should have gone on stage and sung it.
No, I think she was passed away in the late 60s.
So the intro part was from Nuremberg, the first like minute or so. Now this, the remainder of the song is from Munich, the next night. Listen to that energy though, it's great. And again, they might have sweetened a little bit of this, but they're not, I don't think they're doing any overdubs.
I mean, this album is like 70.
76. I think it came out in 77, but it was recorded in like right around this time of year in 76, September.
Yeah, so I mean, you know, live 70s live albums were just starting to become a thing. So I mean, it's like, you know, who knows how much they actually did for it. Ronnie certainly didn't give it a swing.
No, I mean, yeah, he's him and Richie and probably everybody else has been a pretty good one take guys. This wasn't one that I had in my normal rotation.
Yeah, the album?
Yeah.
Me neither. I mean, I've obviously heard this one. You know, the rainbow intro and then the King.
Yeah, my branching off into rainbow didn't go very far until like when I finally just got sucked up into working 100 hours a week and it stopped. Then I had way more money to buy albums but not enough time to actually listen to them. Said the music might be a touch loud.
Not to come. I agree, Rich.
There we go. And that'll be all fixed by the audio podcast, fixed by all the filters that I have in the raise and lower volumes when we talk.
Wait, did you turn it up or down?
I turned the music down a little bit.
Oh.
Oh, I thought Rich was saying it was louder than us, which was a bad thing. That's how I read it. He wants it louder. Well, let us know. Let us know. We got a whole album to figure it out. Will says, considering Long Live Rock and Roll didn't come out until 78, this is a very fully formed version even 2 years earlier. It's true. I mean,
yeah.
That must have been crazy. Like, you're just listening to this. Like, where did this song come from? Are they ever... What is this? Why are they opening? But what an awesome opening.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
And you open your, and it's actually kind of a cool gimmick because you open your live album with the song, and then the next album that comes out opens with the song as well.
Yeah, and I mean, it doesn't. You're right. It doesn't even sound like much different from what we wound up on the album.
Okay, Rich said it was a little hard to hear us. Hopefully it's easier now. Zoom has a very bizarre way of managing that audio that I was trying to figure out desperately, and then had to do it this weird way. It likes to, they're like, on their support page, they're like, yeah, sometimes you just really can't tell what the audio is of everything, but as the host, I'm like, oh, that's cool. Well, thanks for that solution.
Yeah, good luck. Bye.
Like, why don't you just have a volume fader for every channel?
I mean, all of the, at least in the headphones here, all of the, everything is separated really nice.
Yeah, you guys should really come down here and check it out and listen to it.
And you got, like, the keyboards and the the right channel, Ritchie on the left, and then everybody else just kind of spread out.
Now, see, if that crowd didn't come in right there, it was just like all really. I mean, you have
just
to,
nothing.
You have to at least raise the levels of the crowd or something to make it sound like. Especially after that great performance. I mean, wow.
Right. It's called A Man on the Silver Mountain, this one. Hey!
Hey! I love it.
I love how he just do that. Hey! Be like, and this is Man on the Silver Mountain, this one.
A little bit of a speedier version.
Yeah, I always notice that they sped that up during like subsequent live versions. Like even Ronnie like solo would do it like at this pace, if I can remember correctly.
Maybe like what Will was saying earlier about it being fully formed to Kill the King. I think when you do a song in the studio and you play it live, it almost always gets sped up a little. So they're probably so used to that tempo, they brought it right into the studio like they did it live, and maybe that's why it sounds so faithful.
Yeah.
But this was recorded in the first minute of this was recorded at Nuremberg, and then the remainder of it. Oh, I'm sorry. This one is Tokyo in December at an afternoon show.
Yeah, I wouldn't have even known.
Yeah, I mean, it's great that they could make it all. I guess if they have all that same equipment, they can make it sound like it's just one continuous show.
I mean, they did that with a lot of live albums. I mean, the year before, they did it with Kiss Alive. They recorded in Cobo Hall on a couple of different nights. Mm-hmm. They did it with Alive too.
Rich says he likes it at this speed. Said when he played it in the 80s, it was too fast. I don't know if I've ever heard Dio doing this with Dio. I probably did when we went to see him, but
Dio, that's a great thing about Dio is that he always included like his back catalog, like deep cuts, so to speak. But you know what I mean? Like he never, I don't think he ever ignored any part of his career. Well, I mean rock career. I mean he wouldn't go as far back as Elf. Actually, you know what? He might have.
Did you do Hoochie Coochie Mama live with him? Rainbow with Dio?
I wouldn't be surprised if I like found something that said he did, because I just remember him throwing things in, even if it was like a quick like 30-second medley or something, like of things where it's like I can't believe he's playing this. Yeah. But I mean, you know, in the 90s and beyond, Dio was never an act that was so huge that he was just like, oh, we gotta play the hits, you know, type of thing.
Yeah, I guess that's kind of the advantage of being at that level. Yeah. He's not filling Madison Square Garden with...
Like, I felt he always had integrity that way.
I think the roof, the siding guys are perfectly in time with Cozy's snare, so that's what it's blending in.
Cozy definitely adds a lot to the song. Sounds like he's doing a double bass.
Usually had one, bro.
But yeah, it adds a lot more energy to the song than the album version.
You really hear Ritchie just in that one channel.
Oh yeah.
It's interesting, this first side is really Now this is interesting because it goes in this really cool blues jam, but this is from the show, the same venue, same place, but the evening show instead of the afternoon show.
Maybe he felt he did it better at the evening show.
I'm sure, but it's seamless. It sounds...
Yeah.
It sounds like they just went right into it for Man on Silver Mountain, which I'm sure they did at the evening show too.
you know, this one, which we'll hear on Made in Europe, he did this whole blues thing too.
Yeah. And there's going to be, there's connective tissue between all three of these live albums, obviously, but, and there's even one song that's on all three. You know what it is? Does anybody in the chat know what it is?
Not offhand, I forgot.
We're raffling off a $5 Taco Bell gift card for whoever can say. Oh, I'm watching too many of my kids' YouTube videos they watch.
If I guess it right, will you ensure me that I will can stay away from Taco Bell?
Give me. Yeah. Could I pay $10 and not get a $5 Taco Bell gift card? Okay. Rich got it, and it's Mistreated. So we're going to be hearing three versions of Mistreated. Two with Richie, one without.
Awesome.
That's it.
Yeah, I just was like, oh, forgot about that.
I mean, that synth. That synth he's using has no business being in a blues song, but it works so well.
Well, I mean, it's Rainbow, that's why.
Yeah. Scott has joined. Welcome. Good morning, Scott.
What up, Scott?
And Rich points out that he was using that that same blues riff on Nobody's Perfect when they do that little blues jam. Classic little. And we talk a lot on the show about the lazy blues song, but this is like everything that it should be, especially live. It's a little call and response.
Yeah, like I don't think you've ever heard anybody say like, "Oh, good blues synth."
Oh, that's some great blues Moog you're walking in. I say I'm wearing the wrong shirt. I was wearing my Moog shirt last night.
But I mean, you know, for Rainbow, this is a thing. You know, it works.
And Fielding points out obviously that you know, he says Mistreat is obviously a staple for Coverdale. I hear Ronnie sings it. We'll hear Coverdale sing it in two different versions, and then we might hear Glenn Hughes sing it tomorrow night.
God, I hope so.
We're gonna be, by the time Monday rolls around, we're like, I'm so sick of Mistreated.
I'll never be sick of Mistreated. But yeah, I would like, even, I love Ronnie, but I don't know. I feel like I like Coverdale singing it better. I mean, I love Ronnie singing it.
Yeah, it's, I mean, it's hard to beat.
But it's, I would say, like, if you, I could pick my favorite version of you. Although Ronnie does a spectacular job of it.
Yeah.
But like Ronnie with Richie, you still have that Richie factor in there. And I'm pretty sure that he's done it, like, he did it in the 90s too, live, which was really weird because at that time he had Tracy G, who was like a really technical, like,
yeah,
like heavy guitar player. But that was cool too, because it's kind of like hearing, like, you know, blues move or blues synth. It's like, this doesn't fit together, but because, like, you know, these musicians are involved, it's like really wild and cool.
That's cool to put new, give new life to it.
Yeah.
Rich is saying we'll hear Glenn Hughes yelp and whoop it. Oh, Rich, behave. He definitely puts a different spin on it. Will Porter says, Blackmore and Carrie treading on each other's toes a bit here. Not quite the level of telepathy that Richie shares with John Lord. Yeah, I mean, I guess that's what happens when you get a new keyboard player every 6 months. You don't have a time to develop a good as the same rapport you had with Lord. And I guess it's almost kind of cool to listen to this not on vinyl, because hearing all the songs go together, having that one side, one song thing for the next two sides that we're going to hear kind of breaks it up a little bit, because there's such a great, it almost feels like a medley that they're doing at the beginning. And that's because it is. Oh, gotta bring that crowd noise up a little. So you've got Starstruck from the evening show of that same night. It shines from above. You're the man. Listen to those cracks and pops. Scott's gonna have to remind me not to turn on my isotope crack and pop remover. Click that one off.
You're the man. You're the man. You're the man. You're the man.
You're the man. He's like singling out every person in the crowd. You're the man. You're the man. It started, and the first guy is like, oh, me? And then by the end, he's like, I'm starting to feel a lot less special now. He thinks everyone in the crowd is the man.
Man, I mean, when they just like they cut all the sound and Ronnie just sings on his own. I mean, he was good enough. You could just listen to him rip like that for like a while and not get bored. And just be like, he is so good.
Yeah, Will says he goes on a little bit with the ad libs. He said he can't do it.
I love it. I enjoy it.
It's
so
funny
much.
Because we always joke about like the things that he says are just kind of nonsensical, but. Because it's Ronnie James Dio singing it, you're like, well, like, how do I argue with that? Even if he's just saying,
like, when you pointed out at the butterfly ball, he was, what did he say? When your back's against the wall,
you got someone to lean on. He's like, what is he talking about?
It's like, did this just kind of get violent somehow?
Yeah, like... It's like, I don't know what he's talking about, but it doesn't really matter. Well, that's the end of the side.
Nice.
So, I'm the man. You're the man. We're all the man. So.
Oh my God.
So old-fashioned here. We'll have to turn this over. Whoa. We get onto side two. So side two is Catch the Rainbow, a nice long version of Catch the Rainbow. So let's.
Oh, I like that.
That audio set up.
All right. All right. My phone is being charged over here, and so Rich texted me a while ago, and he said, "Of course, you know when Judy Garland died."
When did we figure out when she died, like the actual?
No, I'm not, my phone's back there right now. I didn't Google it.
In John's defense, I think I was the one that knew who did. I would say,
let's say 1968.
Yeah, let's really that early. All right, let's put it in the chat. No Googling. When did Judy Garland die? Who's going to get the closest?
The winner doesn't get a Taco Bell gift certificate.
Yeah, if you don't guess it correctly, then I'm going to send you a Taco Bell gift card against your will.
If you guess it right, you're banned from Taco Bell.
Will Porter says 69. Peter Gardeau, 67. Scott Haskins, 73. Oh, man, I don't... Now I'm guessing myself. I'm gonna guess high. I'm gonna guess 79. Yeah, you know. All right, let's figure it out. Judy Garland. 69.
Oh.
Will Porter gets it.
Oh, I was off a year.
He must have just known because he was on it. He was the first answer. June 22nd, 69. Yep. So yeah, she would not have been able to join Rainbow on stage to sing this, but she could have joined Mark One. She could have sung it with Rod Evans. Listen to this. A fielding foul came in with 74. I missed that one. Will Porter says, not too many Taco Bells over here in the UK. Stop bragging. You're lucky. This one seems a little quiet to me. I'll boost this up. It's obviously a much quieter song. I think the sound just reset, actually. So.
It's the ballad.
My compressor should take care of that for the audio release. But if I know anything about the dynamics of Ritchie Blackmore, he's going to kick it into overdrive.
So now, is this the one where there's like, just this is one side?
Yep.
So how long is this for?
About 15 minutes. Yeah, Jen, my wife Jen joined us for the live stream last night. If she knew that we were listening to a 15-minute song, she would not join us for this one.
Didn't she join us by accident?
I think she did. I think she accidentally clicked the link in the tweet, and then she's like, oh, I don't want to be on this. But she did come back later. Like 2 minutes before we stopped. Fielding says, since the hologram was a bust, maybe Wendy can sue Skittles for using catch the rainbow phrase. Yeah, do they use that? Do they just say catch the rainbow?
Skittles?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because that's not like a thing. Rainbow made that up. It's not like an expression, right? Nobody says catch the rainbow outside of this song.
I've never heard it.
It's not like, hey, you know what they say? You got to catch the rainbow. Like,
I mean, Blackmore and Skittles. That's about it.
Yeah, I'm kind of on board with that. I think Wendy should sue them. What business do they have stealing that? Catch the rainbow. Yeah, and they put out their hands. I never even thought about that. They put out their hands and the rainbow turns into Skittles.
They missed an opportunity, though. They could have, like, you know, totally. Kind of done a partnership with, like, Ronnie.
The perfect spokesperson for Skittles.
Skittles, catch the rainbow! When you're eating those colors, the green, reds, and blues, you gotta chew on!
This is great hearing this live. Like, the same reason I love hearing, like, the Cal Jam version of Mistreated. It sounds so atmospheric when they're putting all those dynamics into their live set.
You know, this makes me wonder, who's singing the background vocals? Because they're seamless right now. Did he overdub them, or is one of the other guys singing along with them?
I'm not hearing any background
vocals. It's pretty low, keys? But maybe it's being doubled by the keyboard, but I thought that I heard that.
Yeah, Scott says maybe it might just be a slight delay. Maybe it was like a delay effect on it. It could be.
Yeah. Either way, it sounds really faithful to the album version, his vocals.
It's funny, you can't really hear the crowd at all during this part. You'd think they'd mix them in a little bit. They're actually not even that much cracks and pops. Norman takes good care of his records.
Mm-hmm.
He was sad he could not join us. I think he's on vacation right now. He's somewhere where he couldn't get in, but hopefully he'll be able to catch these episodes.
He'll be able to catch the episodes.
He can hear his albums for the one last time. There you go.
Is that somebody else?
No, I think it's him.
Take it to the sky. Yeah, he was just doing ride the light or see the night or whatever.
Yeah, he sang it like much more like throaty than he normally does.
Yeah, I was gonna say, it didn't even sound like Ronnie. Is that like Tony Carey?
Maybe he's a pretty good singer in his own right. Maybe Tony Carey did do some backing vocals. Well, you know what? Maybe it says on this. He'll tell you all about which crash cymbal Ian Paice used, but. Somebody in Australia is named Scrooge, but instead of an S, it's a dollar sign. Let's see. It just credits Carey as keyboards. And it credits Cozy Powell as drums, and then in parentheses, get on with it. I love when they put all those like inside jokes in there that I don't understand.
Nobody will get it.
Remember that? Get on with it. Richard Doe.
I feel like these guys were definitely created a lot of songs that we could take in that direction.
The direction for
like extended jams. Yeah, like especially Richie and Ronnie writing together. I mean, they created quite a few songs like that. Or even Richie with before Rainbow with Mistreated, always in these early days, always wrote a lot of songs that were open to
throw in some tapes.
First time since the Purple album.
throw them in live here and there, but not so much on albums. Ah, Peter Gardeau is saying number 50 Rolling Stone after that solo, because did you see that yesterday, the day before Rolling Stone released the top guitarist, and they put Ritchie Blackmore at number 50, which caused a lot of which is why those lists exist, to get people upset and talk Riled about up. Them and get them more clicks.
Right. I want to know who was before him that we would be appalled by.
I bet Peter Gardeau knows. Number four, you know, number 49, Kurt Cobain.
Oh, no, no, really?
No.
Oh, okay. I was going to be like, get, stop it.
I mean, it wouldn't surprise me. They always, you know, they, and it, you know, you can, Kurt Cobain certainly had his place and his influence or whatever, but yeah, it's
influential, maybe, like, you know, culturally, but Peter better player.
Peter Gardeau says Steve Miller. That can't. With a question mark. Well, it's so quiet now. There's so much dynamics in this recording. Okay, 100 greatest guitarists. Oh, that's from 2015. That was a different list to outrage people. We need the most recent one.
To outrage people. It's true.
Finding all old places. Why am I worrying about it? It's a cozy go. There he goes. Throwing most sweeps in. Can't find his dumb list. Who cares?
Like, we know it's ridiculous.
Fielding says he's going to feed the cat and get a coffee. Let me know what happens. Well, Ritchie did a really good guitar solo.
Comes back, what happened? Still on Catch the Rainbow.
Yeah, what did we miss? Well, Ritchie threw in some more sweep arpeggios. Yeah, I didn't see the actual link to that Rolling Stone list. I just saw, well, Candace Knight posted it and was like, furious. And then everyone jumped in and defended her and Ritchie. Know usually what happens. Oh, guitarists. Good job, Rolling Stone. I can't even find you in a Google search. David Frick's picks. Alright. Maybe if I go to Rolling Stone's homepage, we'll be there outraged.
Nate just wants to get outraged, folks. Looking to get mad. He's mad and he can't take it.
Here we go. RollingStone.com. This is all like politics stuff. Where are you just reporting politics now?
Yeah, maybe MTV will go back and play music.
Ed Lasso recap. Where's the. Nah, forget it. This is why I don't bother with Rolling Stone. It's a waste of time. Got a while to go too.
You see, while stuff like this is really good, obviously, like, it's not something that I would ever put on like over and over again, like extended jam albums like this, which is probably why I never got into it. Because I could picture myself looking at it and be like, hey, 15 minute songs, never mind.
Made with love, made with Europe.
Made in Europe was definitely a part of my regular rotation, so that was an exception.
Yeah.
Even though they didn't have a ton of, like, you know, really stretched out songs on there.
It's weird that that's like a single album. And this is, it's only got five tracks on it.
Yeah, it's really short. It's really short, but it's...
I don't know why they wouldn't turn this into a double album.
But I mean, they've made some questionable, you know, choices in the past. I mean, look at the album, the last live album they released with Tommy Bolin, when like his friggin' arm fell asleep or whatever. You know, I mean, whose idea was that? Yeah, that sucked. Let's put it on vinyl.
Let's put that out. Where Tommy could barely play, barely got through the show. Yeah, a lot of Tommy fans are pissed off about that, and rightly so, because it's just, it's kind of like, why? I remember somebody saying a while back that that was like one of their first exposures to Tommy Bolin, and they're like, oh, like, why? Like,
why do people think he's
even,
good?
He's not even doing any solos or anything, and then they heard him on another show, and like, oh, I get it. Like, and learned that he couldn't use his arm. Balls didn't even try doing the show. I wonder if they wonder, they're like, we don't know what we're yelling back at you. Shine. Shine. We don't know what
shine,
that means.
Shine.
We don't know what that means. Hopefully it's good.
See, that's the thing about Ronnie is like, in my personal experience, like, I've never had an off experience with him. Like, every album I heard him on, every show I saw him at live, the time that I met him, he was like everything that I wanted him to be.
Mm-hmm.
He never disappointed me.
Yeah, and it was, and his voice held out right until like the end, you know, like you could tell it was starting to get like a little bit more gravelly and everything, but it kind of had like more like a deeper sound.
Yeah, it was
to
a little
it.
More gruff, you
but
know.
He was still able to really deliver.
Oh yeah.
It's kind of a strange, like very low key ending here. Ronnie just busts back in. Shine!
He would do that. Ronnie was good with the false endings. You know, on occasion.
Perfect timing.
All right. So on to side three of the album. But before we do side three, what do we need to do, John?
We have to thank our patrons.
Yes, of course. Coming in at the core level, we, of course, have at the $7.77 Keep It Warm Rat tier, we have Michael Vader. At the $7 No One Named tier, we have Richard Fusey. At the episode $6.66 tier, we have Steve Coldwell, Arthur Smith, and Anton Glaving. At the $6.65 Almost Evil tier, we have Kenny Wymore. At the Nice Price tier, at $5.99, we got Fielding Fowler. And at the $5 Money Lender tier, we have Greg Sealby, John Convery, German Heindel, Adrian Hernandez, Jesper Alman, Oleksii the Perfect Stranger Slepikov, James North, Mark Hodgetts, Kev Roberts, Will Porter on the call, and of course, Zwopper the Electric Alchemist, and Tim Southern Cross Johnson. Thank you so much to all of you for your continued support of the Deep Purple podcast. All right, we got to get into side three now. So I do have a note from Norman Weichelbaum, who's of course donated this album. And he says, this might be interesting to your listeners. In Rainbow Dio days, you always see a tape recorder next to Ritchie Blackmore's Marshalls. The background is that Ritchie was not satisfied with the Echo effects boards that were available at the time. So he brought his home Iowa TP-1011 tape recorder. Got my phone going off. Yep. His home tape recorder. Where was I? I was on such a roll. It had one specific feature. The machine had a so-called sound on board button, providing echo effect by pushing just one button that adjusted the tape speed. And that's how they fixed problems back in those days.
Hmm.
Well, thank you. Thanks for that information, Norman. That is crazy. And now that would all be done with a laptop on stage. Oh, how times change. Going back to the album, we also had some good notes from our live stream in between. Will Porter pointing out the core set list of 76 would have been the intro Kill to King, Mistreated, 16th Century Greensleeves, Catch the Rainbow, Man on the Silver Mountain, Blues Starstruck medley, Stargazer, Still I'm Sad, Do You Close Your Eyes was an extra encore at some shows, occasionally substituted A Light in the Black for Stargazer. So interesting, interesting set list. And it is noted, I think, in here that they, like a lot of, well, live albums at the time, is they changed up the order because they had to based on the sides of the album. Mm-hmm. So you're not necessarily even hearing it in the correct order, even with things being spliced together from other shows as well. So
interesting. So the order they would have played it in.
Correct.
Yeah.
And I do have another note, which is that the set list from their December 16th show, if I can find it, that opened up with instead of over, it did do Over the Rainbow, but before Over the Rainbow, they started with Jingle Bells because it was so close to Christmas.
That'd be interesting.
And James, which they, it, on set lists, they credit to it. So it was related to James Lord Pierpont, which interestingly, I'm very good friends with his like great granddaughter. So very interesting. Just fact that her grandfather or great grandfather, whoever it is, wrote Jingle Bells. And she's got the same last name. That's why that's why it comes up. Interesting. All right. So onto side three, which is Mistreated from Cologne. I gotta get a whole other record too. Oh my goodness. Just like the old days. It's slowing us down. what's that comic about records? It's like sure they're expensive, but it's a small price to pay for the inconvenience or something like that. So side three on stage, Mistreated. All right, side three, here we go with our first of three versions of Mistreated in these live streams.
Some cool pics.
Oh yeah. Tony Carey holding a big dog. Ronnie on the phone smoking.
Just a few years ago, a song that I'm sure you'll recognize. It's called Mistreated.
Mistreated, this one.
Which one? This one. Oh, okay. Look at that delay he's got as a guitar there. So he's kind of doing a little Catch the Rainbow before he goes into this song. Oh, Steve Caldwell's joined the call.
Hey.
$6.60 in the house. Yeah. Or hose, Will Porter says, like Richie's favorite leg wear, like that picture of him wearing it.
I love it when he did this during this period. Like he's really fast picking.
The wacky guitar pick he has. Have you ever seen his guitar pick?
No. Why even really paid much attention to it?
It's like a pentagon, but like, it looks like a outline of a house.
Huh.
But he uses like a, it's weird.
Well, whatever it does, it worked. Mm-hmm.
Sabbath songs, but he does this one justice.
Yeah, it's weird with Ronnie having such a large body of his own work, which is incredible. Like the few times that I've heard him sing like another vocalist stuff like this or the Ozzy stuff, like the Ozzy stuff doesn't work at all.
Yeah. and I don't know why.
This does reasonably well, but I think it's just because Ronnie is just so distinctive. I've been losing my mind. You know, he can't really do justice to somebody else's stuff. He does to his own.
Peter Gardeau says his first live LP was One More from the Road by Lynyrd Skynyrd, purchased in 78-79. Interesting thing. You know what your first live LP was?
One of them might have been the shirt that I'm wearing right here.
Yeah.
Which actually, I think I've told this story before. I tried to steal it from a leech mirror.
You did tell that story.
Yeah.
Peter Gardeau will appreciate that because it references an extinct New England retailer.
Yeah.
Peter Gardeau says he probably purchased his at Caldor. Didn't try to steal it, though. You tried to steal it, but you were unsuccessful, so you bought it?
No, I was unsuccessful, so I didn't get to have it for a while.
Did you get caught, or you...
I got caught.
You did?
I was in there with my jean jacket on. I was in junior high. And it was before they had the big things, like, that they put the security things that they put on tapes and CDs.
Oh, yeah, they have that big, like, plastic thing that, like...
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I took it, and I was looking at it, and, you know, I just looked around, and I was like... So I just kind of went and store security popped.
Wow, they were on you. They saw the rebel in the jean jacket.
Yeah, big rebel. Anyways, the next time I was able to get this was the Columbia House, what is it, 200 for a penny or whatever it was.
It wasn't quite that good. So what happened? Did your parents find out and everything?
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
And they took away all my cassettes.
Ooh.
For like, I don't know. It felt like a year, but it was probably like 2 weeks or something.
Oh, man.
As punishment. You know, they're like, oh, you love music? Well, now you have none of it.
Don't worry, you can go sit in your room where there's no TV, no computer, no other form of entertainment.
Yeah, just stare at the four walls, which is what I did. Ugh. Angry.
Nope.
Well, you know, I was like 12. I didn't have any money.
Boy.
But, yeah, it was probably the Ozzy albums, this, Tribute, Kiss Alive.
That will ring that neck. And that really clean tone, too. So, Scott Haskin, now that he's in a band with David Stone, imagine that.
Way to go, Scott.
He says that that David Stone told him that Ritchie would tell his roadie to tell David's roadie to tell David Ritchie wanted him to do an extended solo in a few minutes. I always thought it was just the setup of their show. So, I think I had read that somewhere too. That, yeah, he'd be like, oh, by the way, tell him to do a solo. He'd be like, what? Okay, and they'd have to improvise. It's just kind of everything on the fly.
Oh, boy.
So, Will Porter says Made in Japan. It's probably his first and still best. Scott, I believe, is saying that this was his first live album on stage.
That's cool.
I don't know. Speak of the Devil might have been one of them. It was Speak of the Devil, Live Evil, and Tribute. I remember kind of getting all at the same time, or hearing all at the same time, because like my cousin who lived next door had them. I definitely owned Tribute and Speak of the Devil. I don't know if I ever had a copy of Live Evil.
Yeah, this this one and Tribute were probably the first ones, because I was, you know, huge Ozzy fan, you know, when we were younger.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember telling the story about how I was like jealous of you when you got your Tribute CD.
Yeah, that was like the first, that might have been the first day we met. Like, it had come in the mail through Columbia House. It was a CD, and I had just gotten a CD player.
Yeah,
I think I had two other CDs, Living Color Vivid and Janet Jackson's Rhythm Nation. Those were the only two CDs I owned. And then this one came in. It was like my first thing from Columbia House, or maybe I had a couple of others. And yeah, you were like looking through it, because it had way more in the booklet, like a lot of more pictures and stuff.
Yeah.
It's cool.
Oh,
and
yeah.
You know, when you're used to the cassette format was so tiny, like,
yeah, so it's as big as your hand.
So if they wanted to put anything, they'd have to fold it in, and it was so bulky you could barely fit the cassette back in. And it was so small. And then so when they released the CD, I was like, wow, a nice big thing. Of course, it's still what, an eighth of the size of an LP. So you really can enjoy the album art with this.
Right, but before, you know, I mean, obviously, like, records, you know, vinyl had the best packaging. CDs were probably the second best because it was, like, shrunk down. But, I mean, at least you got a booklet.
But cassettes really stunk.
Oh, yeah.
You know, one that would just be, like, the one thing. They wouldn't even have. It would be, like, a... It would just enough to go there and then white on the back.
Oh. Oh.
Like, so you couldn't even print anything on there. Just absolute garbage.
Oh, I know. I was just like, I'd open them up all excited and it'd be like nothing on the inside. It's like, great. Thanks for nothing.
Couldn't even just reprint the track listing. So Rich says Beatles at the Star Club. I don't think I've ever heard that, believe it or not. I'd only have a couple of Beatles live things. They didn't play live for very long. So Steve Coldwell says Cheap Tricks at Budokan, which is that's a legendary album, which I used to take out from the Southboro Library on a pretty much a monthly basis and just keep renewing it.
All good answers here.
Yeah. I feel like there's like a big one I'm missing. I can't think of what it is. Nice.
You know, I always wanted to be into Frampton Comes Alive, but I never was. Because I always heard about how, you know, important that album was, but I remember
listening to it driving around with Jeff, with Dan Pepin's brother Jeff. He was always playing that, but I never owned it.
I mean, there are a couple of good tracks off of it, but I mean I was also never a huge Frampton fan. Although, funny story is my dad liked him when I was little, and he said that I used to call him the Frampton.
The Frampton.
He's like, I want to listen to the Frampton. Just maybe I didn't know how to say the Frampton.
We have the Gardeau on the call here. Steve Coldwell says his sister kept taking Frampton Comes Alive out of the library at the same time. But he didn't. That one didn't make an impression on him either.
What are the 70s? Because 70s were like booming for live albums.
What about you got into the Aussie ones before Kiss? Was Kiss Alive?
I did because I was into Aussie before, I think a little bit before I was into Kiss. Because they weren't really in their heyday, like in the late 80s, early 90s. And, you know, Ozzy was still, you know, he was just coming off of like Ultimate Sin Tribute, and like they just put out No Rest for the Wicked, and that was the new album at the time. That was in 88. And, you know, so he was still pretty much like there, you know. Whereas, like, you know, Kiss was like not really doing anything. Groundbreaking at the time, you know, you had to have been like into that,
right? Because they were, because when you were getting into the stuff, they were kind of in the, maybe their lowest point,
yeah, of
popularity.
Yeah, except for Die Hard, of course. But
I'll have to look through my CD collection, and I'm sure there'll be one that jumps out at me. Like, oh, of course, this one. I can't think of it right now.
But yeah, no, I think I was definitely into Ozzy around like 88. I think I got into Kiss like around like 90.
Sounds like there's somebody singing with him now, though. You're right.
Yeah.
Peter asks when people first saw Dio, and he said he saw him in 92 on the Dehumanizer tour. That must have been awesome. Me, it was 97 in the Strand with you.
Yeah.
I'd never seen him before that.
We've been losing our brains.
Did he go with anyone else?
This is going to be.
I don't know.
Him. He might not know either.
We all forgot.
We found out you saw Richie at there later with Rainbow and didn't even remember. Scott says whenever he opened for Scorpions in Deep Purple. So whatever year that was. All right. Woo! Three sides deep into On Stage. Good version of Mistreated.
But Mistreated's a great tune. Yeah, I like that one. Although there were some things like the way that I mean Ritchie's tone was really good, but the way that he some of the things that he was doing, like the way that he was playing it throughout the song, like mostly like the rhythm Tom. Stuff, not the lead stuff, was.
I just put the you record just put
the
away.
Same record yeah. away. Yeah. Oh, Nate.
I don't remember how records work. Leave me alone. All right, side four.
But yeah, some of the way that he was playing it wasn't. Some of the little nuances he did in this version, anyway, weren't my favorite.
Ritchie's.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll hear two versions with Ritchie, two versions with Coverdale, and then this one with just Ritchie and Ritchie and Roy. So we'll do side four. Now the final side of On Stage. Will Porter says he prefers this, the one we just listened to Deep Purple's live version. So, All right, side four. Here we go.
How you doing up there? All right.
This starts with 16th century green sleeves, Tokyo yeah. evening show, December 16th, opening with you. Jingle bells.
And you. Yeah.
They have the full good. Concerts of this. I wonder if the full concerts are available.
A song from our first LP, a very first one called Ritchie Blackmore's Rainbow. A song about a lady with long green sleeves. We changed it to read 16th century. Green sleeves, this one.
Oi! Oi! This one.
This one, oi! Oh, Ronnie.
Steve Colwell says he didn't get to see Dio till close to the end. Mm. Killing the Dragon tour.
Oh, wow.
Rich says October 31st, Worcester Centrum. That would have been a great show. Mm. October 31st, 1985. Sorry, should have probably mentioned the year.
Oof. Sacred Heart tour. Yeah.
Did you mention the date like that had any meaning?
Actually, Worcester is where I saw the hologram. Worcester Palladium.
I saw that. Sounds funny. Yeah, Worcester is the go-to place where we grew up for heavy metal.
That's where I saw Ronnie's projection.
Yeah, if you still want to see people with mullets, rat tails, and jean jackets with back patches, they are still you can still spot them in the wild in Worcester. At least the last time I went there, which was admittedly a long time ago, but still not long enough to have that be acceptable.
No, it's they've tried cleaning it up, giving a kind of little cultural hub in there. Done a pretty good job. I was been there the past couple of years. They got some breweries and restaurants and things around there. But then it's like it's in a very contained area, and then you stray
from that main path.
Yeah, you take a left, and then you're like, oh god,
it's 1986 again.
Oh,
my good friend lives there. Like one of my oldest friends, she moved there with her husband years ago.
Mm-hmm. Why?
I think, well, she's a professor, so I think she...
Why would anybody move to Worcester?
She works for whatever the university is that's near there.
Oh, there's, I think, Assumption, WPI. I don't know what else is up there.
A nice couple minute little intro there.
I like his accent in the riff with that keyboard that way.
And this is Ronnie's favorite album. So. Steve Pilkington mentions that line in his book about how ridiculous it is.
Yeah, but it's very, very like, medieval sounding.
I always thought it was weird that they called this 16th century green sleeves. I feel like they should have called it 20th century green sleeves. Because it sounds like they're modernizing it. They're not like...
Yeah.
They're not doing like a... Like, I remember getting this and saying, oh, this is going to be like a real traditional. This is going to be like harpsichords and stuff. But no, it's just...
Yeah, this actually, like, the first Blackmore album is probably as close to, or the first Rainbow album is probably as close to what he's been doing for the past like 20 or 30 years than anything else they've done, you know, because everything is so rooted in the, you know, in kind of like the past.
Here we go. There's Steve Pilkington's book on track, Deep Purple and Rainbow. It's a must have. I gotta find where he says that. He's got stuff in here on stage too. This track from the original single session sees our heroes slap bang back into medieval sword and sorcery fantasy territory again. Oh yeah, it says, it's only, he said, it's only been an hour since he locked her in the tower. He says it's kind of, called it a Spinal Tap couplet. It's only been an hour since he locked her in the tower, which presumably was better than, for example, it's only been a bit since we threw her in the pit. so funny. This book is loaded with little like one-liners like that. It's great.
Oh, I love it.
But it's got everything, every album, every song from 1968 to 1979 by both Deep Purple and Rainbow. So it's kind of got like a mixture towards the end, and then morphs into the Rainbow albums.
It's only been a bit since they threw in our shit.
It's been a bit since they threw in the pit.
You know, one thing that I noticed in this is like, he says Greensleeve's waiting. I think it's coming up. No, it's not. But it's this part where on the album goes, yeah, 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 and instead he goes, oh, you know, which is just like, and it's funny because like, he probably could hit that note live, but he doesn't. You know what I mean? Like some vocalists live, they don't do that note because they're just like, maybe it was too much for him to like do it every night that they would perform it. But it's like, I always thought that was interesting that like, you know, he was in his prime and he could have hit that note, but he, you know, sang it a different way live.
Well, I think if you're a really good singer, you're in touch with your voice and how you're feeling that particular night, and who knows, you just say, you're like, nope, this tonight I'm gonna back it off a little bit.
Yeah.
So Peter Gardeau says, this is the first time I've ever heard this record. It is good. Four Pilgrim Hats. He's already not even done with the album. He's given it four Pilgrim Hats. That is a solid ranking. It's just funny.
In the 16th century! You hear though? She's locked in the tunnel! In the 16th century! Ronnie, God.
So these tracks, these two tracks to close it out, seem relatively short compared to the middle section of Catch the Rainbow and Mistreated. Steve Coldwell says also his first time hearing this. Relatively new to the Rainbow material, so there we go. I think too, my like I said earlier, my whole Rainbow knowledge was very incomplete before we started doing the show. But then you've got somebody like Scott who came in through Rainbow, like he discovered Deep Purple through Rainbow, so that really strong background. This one is from Nuremberg, 28th of September. Still, I'm sad to round up the album.
I'm surprised they didn't do an instrumental version on the Rainbow debut instead of having him deal with the lyrics. Still, I'm sad was an instrumental on the album.
That's right. And I, you know, I think Pilkington talks about that in his book. I wish he would follow this up with a book like on like, he's done it on a few bands, but I wish he'd do one on like Whitesnake and then the later Purple albums, because these books are just so much fun to read. It's a song by song, album by album, fun to read, easy to read, lots of little laughs in there. He says, Steve Pilkington says, closing the album, and indeed the Rainbow Shows themselves on both this and the 1977 tour, is a full vocal version of the Yardbirds track recorded as the instrumental closer for the first album. So indeed, the way Dio simply thrives on this melody really makes one wonder why it wasn't done with vocals in the studio originally. That's a very good point. He said this was recorded in Nuremberg, but the vocals were dropped in from another source.
Oh.
Those pauses there, Levin. That's tight.
Yeah.
That's not easy to do.
I thought that the track dropped out.
Me too. I was like, oh no. We made it this far. Makes you wonder, was there like a hi-hat click that they cut out? Because I do that like when I've done studio recordings, is a high, you take out the hi-hat click and then it just makes you look like a genius when you all come in on time.
Yeah.
But to not do that and to have everyone come in that tight is not easy. Will Porter says, tight but loose, to steal a phrase from another band. And Peter Gardo says that book is a great reference. Highly recommended. Read it at the Connecticut Shore last summer. See, while everybody else was reading those, whatever the latest crime novel was, Peter Gardo had his feet in the sand reading On Track. See, Peter's got to figure it out. That's why we like the Peter. Or the Gardo, sorry.
The Peter. Wrong word.
This is kind of something you'd hear like in a live Lord and Blackmore exchange.
Mm-hmm.
But overall, I just love the dynamics on this album. I hate to sound like a broken record because like I feel like everybody says it, but with modern albums, at least the last 10-15 years, you don't hear a lot of dynamics like this. On a studio album, for sure.
Yeah.
Where it's just everything, no matter what they're playing, it's just blowing out your eardrums the entire time.
No, I mean, I would even say that, live recordings would be like the same way now. I mean, they have to be, almost pristine.
That's what always blew my mind about watching the Cal Jam for the first time and watching Ritchie play. With a crowd of, arguably a 500,000 people and playing so gently with this gigantic crowd. I mean, that's what really made it for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I never thought of that until you mentioned that. It's just like, yeah, he's standing in front of just a sea of people that he probably can't even see to the end of. And he's just like,
he's barely touching the strings.
And he's like, yeah, I'm the maestro.
Will says, nice work from Tony Carey here. I agree. I wonder how much notice Tony Carey got about the solo. Tell him to do the solo. Richie says, tell him to do the solo. Hey, Richie says, hey, you gotta do a solo. Oh, crap.
You have to do the solo. Purple Monkey Dishwasher.
It's like, maybe it's like Richie just needed a bathroom break. Go do a solo. Okay. Thank God, as he goes, uses the privy. Which we have a port-a-john outside our house now because we're doing construction. And the first thing my son does when he gets home from school yesterday is uses the port-a-john. He's like, excited about it. He just comes home, he drops his backpack in the driveway, goes in and uses it. It's kind of for the workers, dude.
Hey. Hey, it's a new toy nonetheless.
New, it's quite a toy. Rich is loving that guitar tone.
See
This is awesome. What a great live band. Like, and to think that, I mean, they're playing so cohesively at this point, they would have only been together for a year, a little bit more than a year. This is probably the longest running Rainbow lineup prior to like the JLT era. Before, you know, Tony Carey kind of got he got a real raw deal with Richie. He's in and out, back again, and oh, you're out of the band, but hey, can you come do some more? Can you do organ tracks on like half the new album? You're out of the band, by the way.
Screw you, but I like the way you play organ, so
you know, you can't be in the band, but I really do enjoy your playing, so could you be on the album? And Rich says that Cozy was the right drummer for this band. I would agree.
I mean, basically had all virtuosos playing the band, you know, although I mean, I don't know how much of a virtuoso like Jimmy Bain was, but I mean, he was definitely good. He was solid. But you never hear anybody refer to him as a virtuoso.
Yeah,
but
I mean, and you don't really... Virtuoso bass players at the time weren't really in rock bands, which is odd, right? I mean, I guess it sounds like you find virtuoso, but most virtuoso bass players were playing jazz.
But I mean, you figure that, like, you know, him and Tony Carey are playing with musicians of like this caliber. I mean, you know, hanging with them, they just have to be good by association. I mean, Richie wasn't going to have anybody that sucked in his band,
right? And I don't think having like a, you know, Billy Sheehan in Rainbow would have been the right fit either, you know, or Stu Hamm or someone, you know. It just. They like almost distorted out of the vinyl there for a second when Ronnie really belted it out.
You know, all these guys, you know, with the exception of Richie, probably didn't think they were virtuosos.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably hard to think of your, like, somebody calls you a genius. Yes, I am a genius.
Just... Well, I mean, I can picture Richie with that, but... Richie, you're a genius. I know. Like, if Richie had an iPhone, he'd, like, send you back the fingernails emoji or the nail polish. I know I'm a virtuoso.
Will Porta points out that little tempo change that we sadly talked over. Those, like, really discordant chords. So it says that.
Rainbow.
It sounds like they were saying "Hoorah Rainbow, Hoorah Rainbow," but this is incorrect. The track recorded at one of the German shows in Nuremberg, and what they're saying is "Zugabe," which is German for encore.
Oh.
It would be great if it was like. But Richie decided that they weren't good enough for an encore that night and just walked off.
I love how they end the album like that. They're just like, they're yelling encore, and then it just fades out. And they're like, no.
That's very fitting for Rainbow.
No encore.
Would you don't? Would they stopped recording when there was a riot because there was no encore?
Good night, Springden. There will be no encore.
But overall, very, very enjoyable live album.
Oh, I think so. For sure. Like, I mean, this is one of those that I would like has been on my meaning to listen to it front to back list. And, you know, what better opportunity than right now?
And I'd reached out to a few folks to kind of get their take on what some of the best live, what I was originally thinking is maybe doing live video. And we could probably do that, you know, in the future, since, you know, a few people enjoy dialing into these live streams. For in the future, we could do like a live video performance, and I got some, you know, like, because Rainbow Live in Munich is really cool, and it's got Dio era, you've got David Stone, and it's a really great performance. Mm-hmm. And then York had given me his impressions of the Donington 83 show for Whitesnake, so we could do some, you know, maybe what, maybe that would be the thing. I was always, we always talked about how we don't really typically, we're not huge live album guys or doing live albums on the show necessarily, but people always want to hear them, so maybe we can make it more be a participation thing.
Yeah. No, I think sticking with the whole, you know, I mean, I'm sure there's plenty of other, you know, like proper Deep Purple shows that we could, live ones that we could listen to. But the Dio at Donington double album was like, that's one that's like amazing.
Is that just audio?
I believe so. I think so. There was like one, he did one in 83 and one in 86. So he had it with his like original band and then his band with Craig Goldie, the later 80s. But like, yeah, that's one of the few live albums. I think they released it like, I don't know, several years ago, something like that. And it was, it's a great.
Oh, it was released like posthumously.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Great set though. Yeah. Posthumously. Like, but of those two different sets, and they were amazing.
I'll have to check that out. All right. Well, as we wrap things up, we of course have to thank our core level patrons coming in at the $3 Nobody's Perfect tier and on the live stream, the Gardeau, Ian DeRosier, Mark Roback, Andrew Meyer, Duncan Leesk, and Stuart McCord. And at the $1 made-up name tier, Els Murders, Spacey Noodles, the Drippy Long Stockings of Gravesites, Leaky Mausoleum, Stephen Somerville, the Concerto 1999 fanatic, Raf Kaff, Spike the Rock Cat, JJ Stenard, Hank the Tank, and Flight of the Rat Bat Blue Light. Thank you to all of you so much for your support of the Deep Purple podcast. We, of course, appreciate it. And we appreciate everyone that was able to join us on the Zoom call. We got the chat going here. Appreciate everybody participating. Some great conversation, some great comments behind the scenes, and we'll keep going for a few minutes after we wrap up this episode. But yeah, these episodes won't be terribly long because we're just kind of going right through them, and we're not breaking them up with our ratings so much. So, and I think that's probably the best way to do it, because we had rated a couple of live albums, but I feel like rating them is kind of are what they are, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
I don't know that we need ratings for the live albums.
Well, I mean, if we're doing them in this format, maybe we could do something a little different, you know, aside from rating them, you know.
Yeah, I think Four Pilgrim Hats is a strong rating from Gardeau for the overall album.
I like how we gave Peter a nickname without even consulting
the Gardeau. Well, I mean, that's you don't consult people for nicknames, you just go with what feels right.
It's like you're the Gardeau now.
The Gardeau.
But
I hope there's nobody else with the last name Gardeau that donates, or else it's going to be confusing. Well,
they're going to have to be somebody else.
Yeah.
But I would agree with that. This is a Four Pilgrim Hat album.
Yeah. Solid, fun to listen to. Great performances, great dynamics, like we talked about. Mm-hmm. And like many live albums, I think Made in Japan is one of the only ones that's not really, that's really completely unedited. I mean, they did mix and match songs from different shows, but I don't know that there was much done other than that. But you know, I don't have a problem with, I don't know, people get all bent out of shape about it usually, but I don't have a problem with them splicing songs together or doing a track here or there or sweetening the audience sounds, because I mean, like I said before, sound pretty stupid if you didn't record the audience properly and you're just like, oh, there's crickets.
Yeah, exactly.
Dio's like, yeah, and then,
well, you hear that enough on bootlegs, and that's why sometimes you're just kind of like,
Or it's the opposite. You do, all you hear is the crowd.
Yeah, right. But I mean, that's why doing a proper live album with the, you know, right, mixing and, you know, fixing a couple of things here and there is essential.
Yep, absolutely. All right. Well, a few people signing off here. Steve Colwell's got a run, but he's looking forward to In the Heart of the City, which we'll be reconvening for after lunch. Our time anyway, maybe after dinner your time, or maybe you're still asleep. But thank you to everybody for joining us on the live stream.
Yes, thank you.
Hope this translates well to our normal podcast feed. If not, well, I apologize, because you're gonna get three of these. There's nothing we can do now.
Yeah, you're gonna have to deal with it since I came all the way out here.
Yeah, the die has been cast. Yeah,
just to do it.
If the feedback comes back really strongly, we'll just get you an early flight back tonight.
But then I'll miss the dead daisies. They still go.
Oh, on. Sorry, man. The fans have spoken. All right, thank you, everybody. We will catch you next week with. I think next week we'll have a normal episode, and then after that we'll be back with another
live stream.
Another
episode.
Live stream. All right. Thank you, guys.
All right.
Have a good one.
Thank you for listening to the Deep Purple Podcast. If you like what you hear and would like more episodes in the future, please donate on Patreon to support the show. You can also leave us a review in Apple Podcasts to help new people discover the show. You can follow us on YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook for show updates. See deeppurplepodcast.com for more details. Thank you for listening.